evening. The Rockingham County School Board meeting will now come to order. We will begin with the roll call, beginning with Ms. Tuttle.
Lynn Tuttle.
Ron Bryce.
Virginia Hoover.
Bob Wyatt.
Amanda Bell.
Lori McKinney.
Brent Huss.
Ophelia Wright.
Okay, Mr. Kirkman is not with us this evening. We will proceed with our Vision 2020 statement. The Rockingham County Schools will empower each child to be a lifelong learner equipped to contribute to a changing, complex society. We do have some announcements today. The next work session of the Rockingham County Board of Education is scheduled at 6 o'clock on Monday,
May 7th.
Let's start over. The next board meeting is scheduled at 6 o'clock Monday, May 7th at the central office. Item 2.2, the next work session of the Rockingham County Board of Education is scheduled at 6 o'clock on Monday, May 21st here at the central office. Item 2.3, the Rockingham County Board of Education will hold a public hearing on the request budget for the 2017-18 school year on Monday, May 7th at the regular board meeting. Mr. Parker Turpin will present the request budget, and the public is welcome to comment. The sign-up sheet will be provided for those waiting to speak during the public hearing. I think we need to change that to the 2018-19 school year.
Sure.
Okay, we'll correct that. On 2.4, the Rockingham County Employee Retirement Banquet is scheduled for Thursday, May 24th, 2018 at 6 o'clock at the Rockingham County Middle School cafeteria. All right, let's move, since this is our work session. We have several reports and discussion items on the agenda, and we will begin with item 3.1, machining program update at Reedsville High School. And we talked a little bit about that at the last meeting.
Let me switch it over to you.
Yeah, please, sir. Thank you. Good evening, Chair Bell, Dr. Shotwell, board members. It is, of course, a pleasure to be with you tonight, and excited to bring you just a little bit more information about our machining program that's a possibility, and it's looking like it's becoming more of a reality at Reedsville High School. And I brought a dear friend of mine with me. His name is Mr. Chris Brooks. You probably know Mr. Brooks from Rockingham Community College. He is the chair of the Applied Technologies program. And Chris and I have worked together with Machining Pathways probably the last 5 years,
at least.
And so I brought the expert with me today, and so we will proceed. As you know, the City of Reedsville and the Rockingham County Schools are collaborating with Golden Leaf to hopefully get a $200,000 grant to put a machining lab at Reedsville High School. And we just want to go in just a little bit deeper than I went last month about how that might come about. So just four things we want to talk about this evening. What are some of the challenges that come along with this? Because there are challenges. And anytime you have a major challenge, there's also a major opportunity. So we'll talk about the challenges, and then we'll talk about the opportunities that we have in light of some of those challenges. Then my expert here will talk about what exactly machining is and talk a little bit about the pathways that they're already creating for the machining program over there. And that's the way that we'll proceed. One of my favorite quotes, I always like to hit you with a quote. This quote comes from Hans Meter. He wrote the book on career pathways. And you can read it yourself, but I'd like to hear myself say it too, so I want to read it to you. For too long, education has been something that we've tried to do to a student rather than encouraging and unleashing their God-given talents and aspirations. That's what CTE is about. We have unwisely advised every youth that the answer to success is to go to college, four-year college, by the way, instead of a more humane message, which is to discover your strengths, understand what the world needs, and find a way to apply your strengths to what the world needs. That is the best mission of CTE that I can possibly think of. So, challenges. There are two basic challenges. One is, both of these break my heart. Many students in our schools right now do not recognize the opportunity when one presents itself. They do not recognize a good opportunity when one presents itself. And the second one is equally as heartbreaking. Where even if they do recognize the opportunity, sometimes it's too late for them because they hadn't prepared themselves for it. They're not ready to take advantage of the opportunity. This is something that you did not see the last time, but I want you to take a second and look at it because it's critically important. This is a breakdown of our county, Rockingham County, and these are the jobs that are available in our county. You see the healthcare sector and the manufacturing sector make up a full third of all the job opportunities in our county. Now, healthcare, you see at 18%, we are doing a really good job filling that pipeline. I'll be back later on this spring when I present the CT plan to show you what a good job we're doing at filling that pipeline. You'd be impressed. Manufacturing, not so much. And I'll show you some data. I introduced Mrs. Craddock to you at our last board meeting. She's the rock-a-top lady. That we were able to hire with some grant funds. She had every eighth grader in the system do what fill out what is called an interest survey, meaning that they had to answer a series of questions. Every single eighth grader had to answer a series of questions, and then after they answered those questions, the results would spit out their career interest. So they answer a series of questions, and then the test will say, oh, you're probably the type of person that would be interested in healthcare, or you're probably the type of person that would be interested in engineering, or you're probably the type of person that would be interested in agriculture or construction. Here's the major challenge. The data that you see in front of you is from Reedsville Middle School. Now, take a look at healthcare. That's the big one. I think that's 28, 29 kids. That's the one that goes almost off the screen. Did anybody find manufacturing?
Yeah.
My eyesight fails me as I approach 50, but it looks like one. It looks like one kid, by way of that interest inventory, will be interested in a career in machining. So that's a huge challenge for us. And so, again, I'm going to skip over. What opportunities exist in light of that particular challenge? This is the most important slide from last time, so I want to show it to you again, because this highlights another opportunity. You see at the top, 13% of the people in Rockingham County have a bachelor's degree or more. 19% people in Rockingham County have less than a high school diploma. I submit to you that 67% of the economic future of our county depends on what happens with that 67% of it in the middle. Because, of course, we want as many people to go to a four-year college as possible. It's not for everybody, but we want as many to go as possible. A lot of those kids are not coming back to Rockingham County. Right? So a whole lot of our economic future depends on what happens with that 67% in the middle. And And this is why I want to dig a little bit deeper in the data, because this is something that you don't normally see when you talk, when you hear things about unemployment rates. Because it was something I was confused about for a long time about the Shopwell. Because I would hear our employers say that they cannot find qualified employees, cannot find them anywhere. They're saying that their business is constrained because they can't find enough qualified employees. And I would say, I can't wrap my head around that, because the unemployment rate is about 5.3%, which is pretty close to being fully employed. So I couldn't wrap my head around that. What this data indicates is that, yeah, you might have an unemployment rate of 5.3%, but that doesn't include all the people who are not even looking for work. It's just not that unemployment rate does not include all the people that are not even looking for work. And what I was shocked to find out, as you see in the data here, but I was shocked to find out how many of those people were young, able-bodied people. I want you to look at that age group from 16 years old to 24 years old. Only about, this is a nationwide figure, only about 66-67% of those folks are employed. That means a full one-third of our young people between the ages of 16 and 24 are not employed. I'm not sure what they're doing. Okay, and so you may say, okay, maybe all these kids are in college. So I put up this slide. Look at how many of our kids with a high school diploma are still not employed. Even the kids who graduate high school, we still got about 30% of those kids who are not employed. So what are they doing? That goes back to my original point from just a couple of slides ago. Our economic future in the county, I'm becoming more and more convinced, depends on what happens with that middle 67%, and it depends on what happens in that particular age group, from 16 to 24. The quicker we can get those kids on a career path, the better off our economic future in Rockingham County is going to be. That's the sweet spot. If I find out any different, I'll let you know, but right now it all points to that age group from 16 to 24, figuring out exactly what they're doing and how we can hook them into a meaningful career pathway as soon as possible. And this is my last slide before I turn it over to Chris, because these people are looking. That gentleman with his hand raised, that is Mr. Simmons. He's the owner of Machine Specialties. He'll tell you that the only reason that he can't expand his business is because he cannot find enough qualified employees. He'll tell you that it's proper if I have. And the lady next to him will tell you something very similar. And that's Nancy Tulloch. She's actually the chairperson of our Rock-A-Top apprenticeship program, but she's also the HR person at Pine Hall Brick, who's come on board and is doing a fantastic job for us, structuring our Rock-A-Top program. But she'll tell you the same thing. Her biggest challenge as an HR person at Pine Hall Brick is finding qualified employees. So those are our opportunities in light of all the challenges that I underscored at the beginning. Chris.
Okay, so a little bit about what is machining. And machining, as a definition, is the manufacture of precision-made parts. But that's changed over the last 30 or 40 years. It used to be, we thought about a machinist as someone who worked only in metal, made parts in a nasty, greasy, grimy environment. But that has definitely changed. Right now, when we think of a machinist, it's someone who makes precision parts. It can be out of metal, it can be out of plastics, it can be for making the part itself, or they can make parts to make other parts. Everything we come in contact with in our daily life, a machinist has had something to do with. So this isn't a field that is going to be going away. If a machinist makes the part, like a gear in the transmission of your automobile, or a part for an aircraft, Mr. Simmons on the slide makes a lot of parts for aerospace. A machinist can also make parts for other tooling, like the laptop computers you have. A machinist or a mold maker, which is a type of machinist, will have made the mold that made the plastic part. Or the tires on your automobile, a machinist made the mold that made the tires. The clothes you wear, machinists didn't make that, but they made the equipment that made that. The food you eat, and we can go on and on and on. If a machinist didn't actually make it, they were involved in making the equipment that made it. So what we're looking at for the high school is a combination of manual lathes and manual mills. So in machining, those are two of the large groups of machine tools that you'll see in every shop you go into for the most part. So when we talk about a manual machine, we're talking about a machine that doesn't have a computer controlling it. It still works off of cranking handles, reading digital information, and learning how to stop at the right point, set up the machine to make the cuts. And the reason I feel that's so important, it's the building block of CNC machining, which we'll get to in just a few minutes. It's like any other skill. You have to learn the base skills that go with it. On manual machines, the operator has instant feedback. If they're learning how to do a procedure, they can feel with their hands if the cutter isn't cutting correctly or if this isn't going right or not. On a fully automated machine, your feedback is your part's ruined or the cutter's broken. So for students to learn on manual machines, even though a lot of people think, well, that's older technology, it's still excellent technology to learn on, and quite a few of the companies in our county still use manual machines. I don't think they'll ever go away. So a lathe is a machine that spins a piece of metal, and there is a cutter that moves past that spinning piece of metal. So anything cylindrical would be made on a lathe. A milling machine has a piece of metal or whatever you're cutting clamped to the machine, and you take a rotating cutter and move it past the workpiece. So the whole idea of this is the students learn applications of mathematics. They're having to work with fractions, decimals, measurements. They're having to work with formulas to calculate how fast or how slow they can do something. It gives them a chance to put all these things they've been learning and thinking, when am I going to use this? Well, this is that time. It gives them something to apply it to. Now, CNC machines, CNC stands for computer numerical control. And we're not looking at that at the high school. That takes it up another level. It automates what we've been talking about. But just like anything else, if you automate a process that's bad, you just amplify the poor qualities of the process. But if you automate a process that's good, you get better productivity. So if we can learn the basics with the manual lathe and the manual mill, then when it comes time for a student to step into that next level of CNC, they have that foundation where at that point all they're doing is learning how to automate. They're not having to learn what they're automating. It's kind of hard to automate something you don't understand. So our goal is to get them at that level where they understand the basics of machining, how it works. So we went to Greene County, and this was a project that one of their classes had done. You can see the cannon barrel would have been done on a lathe, the spokes on the wheels, and the wheel itself would have been done on a lathe. The rectangular components of the carriage would have been done on a milling machine. And learning how to problem solve, how do I hold this? I tell my students, you need to think your way all the way through the process before you start. You need to know the last thing you're going to do before you do the first. I've seen them get 90% through a project and realize I have nothing to hold on to anymore. So the problem solving, the planning skills, that all comes into machining. So So this is another view of where we were in Greene County. The milling machines are on the right-hand side. They have digital readout, so they're not completely manual as far as the students have to rely on dials and wheels and all that. There is an electronic component to them, but they give the student the opportunity to get in there, apply these, again, problem-solving skills, math skills. In our classes, we have them work alone and in teams. So we teach them teamwork. We teach them soft skills as well. When you're working with a team and you don't show up for work, this is what it causes. And when you're supposed to be in class, this is what time we expect it to start. Things like that, we try to run it very similar to a business. The last slide is, what would a machining pathway look like? Well, we are limited, just as you are, by SACs, for us, SAC, COC, Council of Colleges, as to how we have to set up our certificates, as well as by the state of North Carolina. But basically, we're limited to 12 to 18 hours of credit in a certificate. And what we would like to try to put together is a certificate that they could earn while they're in high school. So when they finish, they have a certificate in hand that would lead directly into a diploma or an associate's degree with us. If the student chose not to continue beyond that, they have enough information and have learned enough skills, they can use that in the workforce. If they do continue our diploma, they would move into it seamlessly. There are no classes that they would take that would not transfer. Same with our associate's degree. And East Carolina offers a program where an associate's degree can transfer into their Bachelor of Science in Industrial Technology. And they take each associate's degree individually as far as which classes transfer. But it's pretty close to the 64 hours, just like the agreement with the university systems for a general associate in arts or an associate in science. So this can set a student up to start with the certificate. If they like it, they can continue on with a diploma or an associate's degree, and then go, if they want, even farther with a bachelor's. And are there any questions?
Board members, do you have any questions of Mr. Brooks? I wanted to ask the size. What size class are we talking about? How many students are we trying to recruit?
What we would like to do is, the college would like to see 8 to 10 as a minimum, but we don't want to go much over 10 or 12 as a maximum. We have a safety concern. These are real industrial machines. They're not tabletop versions. They do have the ability to, unfortunately, remove a finger. They can hurt you. So with one instructor in the room, we want to keep the number at a manageable level. We want safety to be first. And that would be something in the certificate program we would set up. There would be safety, there would be blueprint reading, as well as the machining classes. But safety is our main concern. We want everyone to leave with everything they came in with that morning.
What criteria are you using to select these children?
That I don't know. That would be for the school to decide.
Okay.
Not much more than they need to be a junior or senior.
Okay.
That kind of answered my question. I was wondering what grade students were you looking at and putting into this program, if they had to be a sophomore or junior?
I think we're looking at juniors and seniors now, mainly for the maturity level.
Right.
Just because these are industrial pieces of equipment and they do need to understand that they can be dangerous, but so can the automobile they came to school in or the school bus. And there's certain rules that we follow. We don't ride on the outside of the automobile, and we don't do this with the milling machine. But we need.
One kind of follow-up question with that. Will this be a program that the students would participate in both semesters, or would this be for one semester?
This would be at least a two-semester. And that's going to go back to how much time the school is willing. We haven't discussed blocks of time at this point. But right now, the certificate that we offer at the college with the CCP pathway, they meet 15 hours a week for two semesters. So depending on the amount of time that they met, it would determine whether it was a two or even longer than that semester program.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else? Mr. Huss?
Yes, I had a request for Dr. Scott. The questionnaire that was given to the Rockingham Middle School children, could we, as a board, have a copy of that? I'd be real curious.
Absolutely. It's actually a link from the College Foundation, and I'll send it to you this. I'll send it to you first thing in the morning.
Thank you.
But in Friedman Middle School that you did it with, right?
Or was it all everybody. Everybody. Every okay. single eighth grade.
And one thing that's
all middle school. Okay.
I'm sorry. Every eighth grade.
Okay.
We were at one of the local high schools during lunchtime last week. We had a lot of students come over interested in machining and didn't realize, oh, that's part of machining. Oh, that's part of machining. Mm-hmm. And like Dr. Scott has said, a lot of times the students don't know what they don't know. And I know we present it to them, but until they're really interested and wanting to absorb it, a lot of times that's when it clicks. Oh, this attaches to this and this relates to this.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Okay, Mr.
Application to get into this, do they get information about what type of benefits there are for a future? Because one of the things that they're looking at is they may be in need of money and looking at an immediate reward of getting a job and working in that field and developing their skills, and they're looking at an occupation for the future.
That hasn't been worked out as far as information given out with the application.
But that absolutely will be. As a matter of fact, we Chris and I did a clip 4 or 5 years ago, and I'll shoot you all a copy. But yeah, there absolutely be promotion, and there's a clip that promotes machining pathway from 5 years ago that I'll copy to all of you all. But also, I didn't want to take time at this meeting, but that clip there, that you should have in PDF form. I think you can still follow that link. It's about a 5-minute clip. It will, as my mother used to say, bless your soul, to see, and I think things like that, if our kids can see things like that, which we will show them, I think that will pique their interest a whole lot. That, yeah, this might be for me if you want to take a look at that machining clip. It's encouraging, to say the least.
Okay, are there any other questions? Okay, thank you, Dr. Scott.
Thank you.
Mr. Brooks, we appreciate your presentation. We will now move to Dr. Perkins, and he will present personalized learning and the instructional framework.
Just give me just a second. Set up.
Are you going to do
yes,
it?
Yes, ma'am, I'm going to. Good evening, board members, Madam Chair, Dr. Shotwell. I wanted to give you an update tonight on some work that we've been doing on personalized learning. Back in the fall, the Department of Public Instruction released an opportunity for all 115 school districts to apply for a digital learning grant. And Rockingham County and the Curriculum Instruction Department submitted an application, and we were one of 21 districts that were selected and awarded the grant for $50,000. And the grant was designed for us to begin exploring additional ways to provide personalized learning opportunities for our students. So, I have a presentation I would like to share with you. And if you notice, the date for this is May 10th, 2018. On that date, our district has to present to all the other districts that won the grant our progress and updates. So that's why, and we had to already submit the presentation, so that's why the date is May 10th. But I wanted to talk to you a little bit about the progress that we've made and the work that is coming in the future. We started with our strategic plan, and if you look at Focus Area 1, graduation and beyond, one of our goals was to develop personalized mastery approach to learning for each child to graduate prepared for work, further education, and citizenship. And much like you just heard from Dr. Scott, personalized learning is an attempt to really identify the individual needs and moving forward with that. So as we think about personalized learning, we have to start with our teachers, because we have to train our teachers in order to have a shift in instructional practice. And a lot of what we think of as traditional schooling, it is a shift when we think about personalized learning, because we now focus on not did we teach the content, but did students master the content, and that is a shift. The strategies, again, will focus on providing professional development and administer surveys to assess student interest and to provide offerings for our students. So what you'll see, I know this is a little hard to see, on the left of that graphic is part of the plan that we actually had to submit. And one of the biggest components of this grant is we developed a personalized learning academy in which each school identified one personalized learning, what we call ambassador, personalized learning ambassador, to do the work that we set out to do within this grant. So a lot of that started with just teachers that had an interest in personal learning. From that, it grew to a network of teachers that really worked together to build a series of resources that can be shared with all of our teachers. So the Personalized Learning Academy is one of the biggest components of that. I want to show you in just a minute our Personalized Learning Instructional Framework, which we'll be rolling out to all of our teachers this summer and during the first work days when we come back in the fall. And we're proud of that work, too, and you'll see that in just a second.
May I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am.
I read through this, but I didn't know what ERG stood for.
Education Resource Group. It is a consulting firm that our district has worked with for years. They're based out of Winston-Salem.
Okay, thank you.
So we did some consultant work with ERG on personalized
learning. ERG, Educational
Research.
Research Group.
I think it's actually reading. It started.
It's research.
Is it research? Mm-hmm. It's either research or reading. I'll send that to everyone to confirm. We also sent all the personalized learning ambassadors to NC TIES, which is a conference that's held every year, very popular technology innovation and education society is what that stands for. This past week, we had several teachers attended a field trip to Charlotte-Mecklenburg schools to visit two schools that have completely adopted personalized learning, and they had a great time and saw a lot of good things there as well. And then a lot of the other work has been set up to start a badging program or micro-credentialing program where teachers, as they accomplish some of these workshops, they will earn CEU credit, continuing education credit. And we are moving to badges, which is much like when you think of Boy Scouts. Once you complete a workshop, you earn a specific badge. And that badge does equate to continuing education units. It's very popular now. And one of the things that is kind of happening as a movement across the country and state is not only do you get your badge that you can attach to your email signature, but you also get a physical, like vinyl badge that you can attach to your computer or your favorite mug, and it's just like it's a badge of honor, and they're very popular as well. So we were spending a lot of time working on that, and then also working on developing the resources that we will need. So this is our instructional framework, and if you look at it, it's set up as a student, a graduating student. And what we want our students to do in this personalized learning model, you can see in the center star, the big yellow star in the center, it says personalized learning. We want all of our students each and every day to think, read, write, talk, and do. And if they do that in every day in every class, they've had a full day. So that's that instructional framework. It is grounded in the blue stars at the bottom. The middle blue star is the North Carolina Standard Course of Study. And that's the core instruction that our teachers are held to teach every day to our students. And the five stars around the Standard Course of Study come from the five National Board for Professional Teaching Standards, or the National Board, five core propositions. And you look at those, it requires teachers to have expertise and to continue to work on improving their expertise, teachers to analyze data, teachers to collaborate and work with each other, teachers to reflect, and also teachers have to have that commitment. So those are the five practices we'll be grounding everything in as we develop professional development in this personalized learning model. And then when we look deeper into personalized learning and what we're going to do as far as rolling out training for our teachers, we have set up personalized learning in three focus areas. So one focus area is the learner, which is the student. One is the environment, which is the actual classroom or school, and the other is instruction, which focuses on our teacher. So the personalized learning ambassadors, the work they've been doing over this year, you see each of these categories under learner, environment, and instruction. Those are individual badges or courses that teachers will actually take to get training, to get CEUs, and to gain expertise in personalized learning. We have worked really closely with Angela Martin, our beginning teacher coordinator, with this. We will be providing a lot of training with our beginning teachers and making sure they understand this model. And then also our personalized learning ambassadors will be training with our instructional coaches, will be training teachers at all the schools as well. So when you look, when this is all finished, when you look under, say, environment, if a teacher wanted to work on classroom culture, there will be a course module that has been developed by our teachers here that they can submit and take through Canvas to get credits and CEUs for that as well. Some of the most popular things that or courses that we think we're going to have are really staples and solid components of personalized learning. And if you look under learning, student voice and choice is very important because it gives students choice in what they want to do, how they want to learn, what projects they want to take on. Opportunities to think, read, write, talk, and do, again, goes back to support our instructional framework. And then the under environment as well, paces, pathways, and playlists. That just means there's lots of variety in how teachers can offer students opportunities to demonstrate mastery in certain areas. So instead of just having a 25-question test, which is what school's been about in the past, there'll be many options for students to identify through projects and rubrics they've obtained mastery in that area. So the last thing that the personalized learning ambassadors are creating are all these resources. They are all links. I won't go to them, but when you click on the first one, it takes you to the Canvas course shell, which if you're not logged into Canvas, you would have to log in there. But we've already created the course shells for all the courses. We actually have also created the action plan template, which will work very nicely and feed right into teachers as they present and work on their professional development plan goals at the beginning of the year, in which they can select personalized learning as one of their goals as well. And then we've developed all the badging systems as well, and they're all housed in that professional learning model binder. So that's a lot of information, so I just wanted to present it to you before we present it on May 10th, and be glad to take any questions that you may have.
Board members, do you have any questions? I think. The ambassadors that you're referring to, so this, you're using a train-the-trainer model in order to do this. And when you look at your modules, how much time in order for a teacher to complete that particular module, flexible learning spaces, and how much time do they spend in each module in terms of trying to really grasp?
Right. We are setting them up with the intention of them getting a full CEU credit. So one CEU credit requires 10 contact hours of instruction. One of the initial badging I guess, metaphors that we were going to use were sports themed. So you would have like a rookie, you'd have a veteran, and the shells can be created where you can kind of break them up. So instead of doing the one whole CEU, you may get a half CEU if you just do half the course. So we're trying to build levels in like that as well. Because we do allow half credit, half CEU credit to be baked in the HRMS system.
Okay. Is there anyone else?
Every teacher will get this. They can put it in their classroom every and have the post. So this will be something that reminds them this is that instructional framework. So we're excited about that. And a lot of this work was, all this work was led by Christy Barham, and Christy has done a great job of training all the personalized learning ambassadors and even me, so I feel capable of carrying on now. So
we're going to have to get someone to replace her, huh?
Yes, ma'am.
Is Charlotte Mick, are they actually leading this?
Yes, they... Charlotte Mech and Wake County are leading it. Charlotte was one of the 21 districts that got a planning grant. Just today, Dr. Shotwell signed another grant that have submitted for $150,000. They're only awarding 15 of them, but the feedback we've gotten is the 15 winners will likely come from the group of 21 that won the first round. So we're really pleased with the work we've done, and we're hopeful that we can continue with that with the additional grant as well.
And it's through the digital learning?
It's through digital learning with the Department of Public Instruction.
Good. Well, good luck on that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Turpin.
I'm doing a question. Is this, and I don't know whether I missed it, is this a reoccurring grant?
No, the grant was 50. We obtained the funds in December of this year, mm-hmm. and we had to have the funds spent. By last Friday. So we encumbered our last dollars on some resources last week. So, but the new grant cycle started today, or I guess the deadline was today. We submitted that today, and we will know in June whether or not we get the next grant.
And just a point of clarification, Madam Chair, ERG is Education Resource Group.
Resource.
Yeah, that's what we said.
Education research. Right. That's what I have. Resource instead of research. Okay. Did everybody get that? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Perkins. We will now move down to 3.3, instructional resources to support MTSS.
And Ms. Holly Williamson is going to join me for this presentation. She is our district-wide MTSS lead coordinator for the district. And we had on March 22nd, the Curriculum and Instruction Department and the MTSS committee hosted a vendor fair where we brought in four vendors to look at the resources that they provide. We have, as we move closer to 2020 goal of implementing fully MTSS, one of the things we have are some research-based diagnostic assessment capabilities in order to proceed with that. So we had to do some research and look at different vendors that provided that resource. But I wanted Holly to quickly first give you a quick reminder of what MTSS is, just so we're all familiar with that. So I'm going to turn it over to Holly.
Thank you. Good evening. It's been a while since I've spoken to you about MTSS. I think maybe we did an update in the fall or late summer. So I just wanted to kind of go back through with you what MTSS is. So basically, it is a school improvement framework. It's multi-tiered systems of support. And it's basically providing the leadership structures and the problem-solving capabilities for teams to be able to meet the needs of all children. So we are working in teams to directly identify student needs and then to also put interventions in place to address those needs and those areas of concern. This is an integrated system, so we're looking at behavior, attendance issues, academics and also social emotional concerns. And I think in an earlier presentation this year, we talked to you about that whole child wellness, and this is directly related to that. This is about providing supports to all students where they are. So it may be that we're providing the supports through the core curriculum. It may be that we're having to provide supplemental instruction, or maybe intensive intervention. So we're looking at three tiers of intervention, tier one, two, and three, or sometimes called core, supplemental, and intensive. And we also have to progress monitor these interventions, so to make sure that we are doing what kids need, and to also make sure that they are showing growth and progress along the way. So we're looking at that student outcome data, and we're keeping track of where kids are once they've received intervention. These teams, our MTSS teams, our school leadership teams, are looking at the resources that are available in their school, and they're having discussions about how to allocate those resources to meet the needs of students. They're looking at the staffing that's needed to support it. What programs do we currently have available, and what curriculum do we currently have available to support the work? And they're also looking at professional development needs. So by 2020, the state of North Carolina has mandated that all schools, all public schools in North Carolina, adopt and start to implement MTSS. And we, Rockingham County Schools, are participating as cohort one. We were actually a pilot district, so this is our third year of implementation for MTSS. We have 14 schools that are currently implementing or in the training phases. We're using a cohort model, so we're bringing on a few at a time. Right now we have 14 schools that are a part of this work, and the remaining schools will come on board in the next year or so. Again, we're providing the training in tiers as well, so we're teaching them about how you provide core supports and intensify the strength of your curriculum, and then we're also looking at the interventions that we can provide to students at supplemental and intensive. And this all directly ties with our strategic plan for the district. When you read through that strategic plan, you will see MTSS or components of it all throughout the strategic plan. Our goal is to make sure that we are effectively meeting the needs of as many people, children, students as possible, while also addressing those individualized needs of students that require more support. So we are using what the state is recommending as a standard treatment protocol. And that means it's kind of following a medical model that we are applying specific interventions. So if a student comes to us with a specific area of concern, that we already have a set pre-prepared intervention ready for that child so that they can immediately access the interventions that they need. So that's kind of like the medical model. When you go to the doctor and you have sinus congestion, and the first thing they do is give you a Z-Pak. And so that would be a tier two support, a Z-Pak. But then if you still continue to have difficulty and you developed a bronchial infection after that and you have to go back and get a more potent antibiotic, that would be like your tier three support. So it's kind of following that medical model. We do have to provide progress monitoring for each of these interventions, like I said before, just to make sure that students are making the progress that we need to see. We are looking to see what types of gaps that we have currently in regard to resources and intervention programs. The interventions that we put into place have to meet these criteria. They have to be research-based, evidence-based programs. They have to build on each other in scope and sequence. They have to have that progress monitoring and diagnostic tool, and then they also have to be something that we can utilize consistently district-wide. So we are looking to put all those components in place for that standard treatment protocol, but as we have entered into this work, we have found that there are some gaps across the district. We have like a preliminary idea for what the standard treatment protocol is going to be for literacy, but we have some holes to fill because we have to address all areas of literacy. We're looking at fluency, phonemic awareness, the reading comprehension component, the written expression component. All of that has to be addressed, and then we also have to have interventions in place for math as well. We're doing a good job with behavioral interventions because we've been doing PBIS for some time, so everybody has a good understanding of how to intervene as far as behavior is concerned, but we need to fill in some of these holes as far as interventions for academic. Until we can put all of these things in place, we will not meet the criteria for the state We are moving toward a model for identification of students with specific learning disabilities. By July 1st of 2020, we will no longer be using a discrepancy model to identify students with learning disabilities. Instead, the MTSS model will be used. So the progress monitoring that we gather from those core tier two and tier three interventions, that data is what is going to be used to determine whether or not a child meets the criteria for eligibility for a specific learning disability. So it's really important that we have all of the interventions that are needed in place and also that progress monitoring component in place by July 2020.
Board members, do you have questions for Ms. Graves?
I'm going to ask one question, please.
Yes, ma'am.
In regards to the math, I mean, I heard you say all that in regards to literacy as well. Do we have the resources to meet those needs for math, or do we have to find the resources then?
We do not have all the resources that we need at this time.
So on the 22nd, when we had our vendor fair, we had four companies come in, Moby Max that represents math, Achieve 3000 that represents literacy, iReady, which represents both math and literacy, and then Prodigy, which just represents math. And we chose these based on the criteria that you see on the board there, the enrichment program criteria under the second bullet. They are resources that would meet those criteria there. We currently are using the Achieve 3000 also for our elementary and two of our middle schools. So we currently have that in place, and it's a great resource. Our recommendation, and then also we have MCLAS and foundations and all kinds of other things for literacy. So our recommendation is to maintain what we're using currently in literacy and add Achieve 3000 for all of the K-8 schools. And we were able to negotiate a really good quote for that program. iReady is hands down the best resource for the math that we looked at. It is hands down the most expensive as well. One of the things that's a challenge for this is having something that builds in scope and sequence, as the presentation said, but also something that has a diagnostic, kind of a universal screener, that we can get that initial assessment from everyone. And there are a lot of programs out there, but not a lot of programs that have all those components in it. So we are currently negotiating with iReady to provide us an updated quote. I know Dr. Shotwell spoke with the representative again, was it Friday? So we're hoping to have something that is workable for us. And just as a reminder, the funds that would pay for these resources are coming out of the state textbook fund, which, as you remember, starting this coming school year, 18-19, can no longer be used for anything other than instructional resources. And digital resources as well. And if we haven't had textbook adoptions in a long time around here, but you could not outfit one grade level in all areas for the amount that we get with our textbook adoption. So the technology option is really the only option for us, because we have to have something that identifies all students or helps all students. So our recommendation is Achieve 3000 for reading support and iReady for math support. And I'd be glad to take any other questions that you have.
Ms. Wright.
Do you have a committee who's working along with you to review what you're looking at, like your lead math teacher?
Yes, ma'am. Mary Doggett has reviewed the resources. We have shared it with our instructional coaches. We had a committee of probably 10 or 11 that listened to the presentations from the companies when they came. So yes, we've vetted those. We've actually visited school districts that are using iReady. Holly took middle school principals to Chapel Hill a couple weeks ago to see it in action as well.
Anyone else? Okay, are these vendors, don't they have to be on the state list?
I'm sure they all will be and are. If they're not, but I can check on that.
So are you, I think the process is sort of like how we used to select textbooks. So you have
we have a committee.
We used to say textbook committee. So you have a committee to look at.
Yes, ma'am. And we have already reviewed it and and those are the recommendations we have. One of the things, because of the price, we would be coming back once we get the actual quotes for the resources and provide, come back to you for approval for that.
Okay. That was going to be my next question. What do you need?
We plan to, if we can get that quote in for the May board meeting, we would like to come back and share that information with you.
Okay. So most of the other districts using these?
Well, because we're in cohort one, a lot of districts haven't even begun to think, well, they've begun to think about this, but they're not quite at the place we are. What we're realizing is, as we have added more schools into our cohorts for training for MTSS, we realize that 2020 is right around the corner, and we have to have something in place because the old method of identifying students with specific learning disabilities is going away. In MTSS, that process is replaced, so we have to be ready and prepared for that.
That's right.
So did they put any sample materials out?
Yes, ma'am.
For the teachers to look at?
Yes, ma'am. They provided, I already provided them both the print and online access for all of us, and a cheap 3,000 you already have, right. So we've already reviewed that.
Are there any other questions? Okay, thank you, Dr. Perkins. We will now move to item 3.4, community survey for renaming New Vision / Dillard Elementary School. Dr. Shotwell.
Yes, Madam Chair, board members. What you have before you, we received over 115 different ideas, but as I said from the very beginning, we have to embrace the history that we have had at the school and the impact that Mr. Dillard had on that community. And as a result, you have five names before you that could be potential names for the merged school: John W. Dillard STEAM Academy, Science, Technology, Engineering, Arts, and Math; John W. Dillard Academy for Math, Science, and Arts; number three, John W. Dillard Academy; number four, John W. Dillard Western Rockingham Academy; and number five, John Dillard Community Academy. And what we would do, we would take these five choices and then we would survey the parents at both schools and then come back with some of the top recommendations and hopefully present it for consideration on May 7th.
Board members, do you have any questions of Dr. Shotwell?
I knew better than to bring 15 to 20.
Right, that would be the problem. Okay. Any questions in terms of the process?
So the process is these five will be put out to the public?
Yes, ma'am.
And then the results from them will be called back to us for consideration?
For consideration. Ultimately, you all have the final say.
Ms. Wright?
But I thought I heard you say that they would be put out to the schools.
To the two schools.
Two schools.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then community or just the two schools?
It would be out to the two schools, but if they have access to the web link, it will be on the web page during that time. I mean, if somebody in the community wants to vote on that, they can, because we'll have a place on there where we're asking them, are you a parent, student maybe want to have part of the name, okay, community member, a teacher, and so we'll know who all is voting on this.
How will the announcement be given to the community if they want to participate?
Well, what we can do is we can put that, because Facebook tells all truths. So we will definitely be putting it out on Facebook. Yeah, I was a little tongue-in-cheek there. Sorry about that. But it's the truth. A lot of people do look at that stuff. And so we'll put it out there on Twitter. We'll also do an alert now to the two schools and let them know that it's out there. And we'll also we'll put it in Friday folders at both of the schools for them to take it home. And then, then we'll have it on our web page as well.
But it would not be announced in the Madison newspaper,
anything like that? It could, but the addition for this week is probably, the deadline is, when is it, Justin?
Tomorrow. Probably today.
Today? So you could put it in a newspaper article, couldn't you?
Yeah.
Okay. Because we waited until next week, by the time it would come out, it would be the day that it would be ended.
I just want to make sure that the public knows, because there are many public concerns. And I would want to give them that opportunity. Okay. They don't have children in school.
I got you.
Are there any other questions for Dr. Shotwell regarding the naming of the merge schools?
I have a comment.
Okay.
It's good to see that John W. Dillard is a part of the name and not changed.
Everything I learned through my dissertation process, it was about the desegregation of schools and how both white and black schools lost their identity because people didn't pay attention to the traditions. And so I would be highly at fault, and I'd probably have Dr. Coble and several others come back and revoke my graduate degree if I didn't take that into consideration.
Good point. Okay, if there are no more questions of Dr. Shotwell, we will now move to 3.5, the revision to the 2018-19 traditional calendar for spring break. Dr. Shotwell.
Yes, ma'am. Let's see. I'm waiting for the gerbils to get going in my computer here. There we go. What we're doing is we're asking to move spring break to be more in line with the people that are around us. As you know, this past spring break, because of snow, we ended up having to use the Monday after Easter for a school day. However, there were still several athletic events, Easter tournaments that were going on because other schools were out. And so on that particular Monday, we counted the students that were, I think it was softball and baseball, were out. We counted them as a field trip that day because they didn't know on Saturday if they'd be playing on Monday or not. And then when we realized most of the school districts around us were the week later than us. And so what we're asking for is to do an adjustment. And by doing that adjustment, we'll be in line with Guilford, Alamance, and Caswell, and a few others that are outside of our district. Stokes County will be the week before, but this has been a request. And what you have before you here, I'll bring back to you in May for approval, unless there's a point of discussion.
This will be on the table for people to see that the suggested change, just in case people plan something a year in advance already. You know, once they got the other calendar, they may have already planned something for that week, thinking, you know, I can plan this now because the calendar's set. So I'm just suggesting that we get this out there so that they can see it, if they have comments, or if they need to make some changes.
We'll treat it just like we did the regular calendar, and we'll send out an alert now to everybody. And this doesn't affect the new merged school. They're out already that week, so this wouldn't impact them. And the early college is already kind of on their own. We would still take those students just like we do now when we're not in session. We still pick the students up at their home school and then transport them to RCC. The only difference is we don't go door-to-door pickup, because when we're all in session, we go around and pick them up. And that, like, if I live in McMichael, I get picked up, go to McMichael, I get off the bus, and then I get on another bus that's taking me over to RCC.
I had a positive comment. I've heard from many, many parents that apparently, going on vacation is a little bit more economical during that week. So I just heard, I can see that real positive feedback from the public from the past discussions.
For going the same week, you mean, or the week before?
We're having basically the entire week off.
Oh, I got you.
Yeah, the week you're proposing changing it. So, yeah.
I got you. Okay.
Well received.
Okay. Let's move to 3.6, UNC Greensboro co-admission report.
I'm going to, this is really going to kind of encompass also 3.8. They're kind of all together, because when we talk about co-admission, we're talking about the number of kids that are enrolled at the school. And again, there goes my computer doing that same wonderful thing. So I never get to see what this thing coming up on here. One of these days I'll figure it out. Yeah, so you can't figure it out. All right, we're good. Here we go. So what you have right now, this is as of late Friday, we have 300 students that have enrolled in the partnership school for 2018-19. You got, you all already have this in your inbox whenever the board meeting is over with. All but about 10 of the enrolled students are from grades kindergarten through fourth grade that currently attend Mall Street, or the next year's kindergarten class who would have been assigned to Mall Street. So there's only 10 outside of that, what we would call an attendance zone there. Kindergarten enrollment is the level that needs the most attention. They are working with the local Head Start, NC Pre-K, and preschool providers to locate rising kindergarten students and get them enrolled. They're also working with local faith communities that have been very helpful in assisting with the student enrollment. The community council meets the same night as the Board of Education to further work on the enrollment and to discuss other support services that need to be provided for the partnership school. This past Saturday, I'll have numbers for our board meeting when we come back together on May 7th. The partnership school did sponsor a trip to the Science Everywhere on the UNCG campus Saturday, April 21st. In the past, they've had anywhere from 5,000 to 8,000 people from all over Guilford County and surrounding counties to come. Every department in the entire university participates. They have something going on that revolves around science. And UNCG paid for bus transportation, which we provided with our activity buses and drivers, and the children and family members were able to eat free at UNCG cafeteria. They were given vouchers to be able to eat there. And Science Everywhere is an annual event at UNCG, and it's a great learning experience that is fun for everybody. They've got it everywhere. And it's really an awesome opportunity. I went many years ago when it first started, and it has definitely grown tenfold since then. The Mall Street Partnership School Principal has been appointed, is what I've been told, and the announcement will be made shortly. They're working through their human resources and everything else, so they have kept it on the confidential basis, but it should be any time now. Interviews and hiring decisions are currently occurring for teaching positions at the partnership school. About 10 kindergarten through fifth grade teachers have been recommended for employment. Interviews for professional educators in the arts, special education, health, PE, and student support will begin shortly. Interviews for the business HR manager and the data manager are also scheduled. And a meeting to discuss provisions of special education and related services and student support services is held today, April 23rd. The partnership school will provide a full complement of special education and student support services to respond to the individual needs of the students at the school. Madam Chair, that's what I have at this time for items 3.6 and 3.8.
You combine them. Okay, do you have any questions or Dr. Shotwell regarding partnership school? Any questions?
You mentioned 300 students. What's the anticipated or the ideal enrollment that you
Well, they based it on this year's enrollment at Mall Street, which is 420. So And like I told y'all before, the students that are in kindergarten through fourth grade, after several different waves of trying to receive the applications for attending the school, all the ones that have not responded have been placed on a Google map. So they can share that information with some of our community partners to help go out and help those parents or guardians be able to sign the kids up. I mean, and when we get to that point, when they're going out to the people to get them to sign them up, literally all they'll have to do is sign their name. It'll already be pre-populated with all the information on there for that particular student. Of course, kindergarten, we don't know who they are right now, but for anybody who's in kindergarten through fourth grade, we do know who they are. We have their information there, so therefore we can pre-populate the application for them to be able to sign it. I'm hoping that my that my memo made some sense. What has happened for us is that when we started doing our student transfers, every student in the district has to have a school assignment, regardless if it's the partnership school or anything else. Well, and by going back and looking at the minutes of the decision to allow the students to stay at Dillard School, that's not in question. What was in question was defining what that attendance zone would look like. And in doing so with that, we also looked at Mall Street. And I consulted with Jill with both of these, and she says they've got to have an attendance zone. So for us, we are still going to look, and I'm going to slide this up here. We're going to look at, let's look at Dillard first. Because what happened when we said that the kids could stay there, we did not redefine the Dillard attendance zone here. What was done was that this whole western area could feed into that school, and of course any students outside of that for the magnet piece of it. But when we went back and looked, these students right here were not assigned. The reason that's an issue is that we have students, we have right as of today, we have 41 students who are asking to go to either Stoneville or Huntsville school and not attend the merged school. A lot of it is just they want to be on a traditional schedule. However, so what I'm asking you all to do in May would be to approve the area that I've got highlighted in yellow. Basically, it's the Dillard attendance zone. This year would be their attendance zone beginning in 18-19.
I don't see any changes in it. Are there any changes in the zone?
No, sir. That dark blue line is the same one y'all been seeing since we started presenting maps.
Okay.
The only thing that was different was dividing Mayadan and Madison up between the two schools.
Right.
Now, what we are going to do is that students that are attending Stoneville, we will have either three or four pickup spots in this zone area for those students to be able to attend Stoneville who can't afford transportation over there. Same thing will be done for Huntsville. It'll be three or four pickup spots here in Madison. Because what you don't want, what we're trying to do, remember what we were trying to do with redistricting to begin with, was to have efficiencies with our bus routes. And if you start having bus routes going all over the place, you've got three or four buses covering three or four different schools going down the same road, that defeats the whole purpose. And obviously, if a person has family that lives in the Stoneville area, that's right near a bus stop, and they want to be picked up there, but they live in that Dillard zone, they can do that, because we do that now for kids.
Yeah.
You know, that if they're out of district, if they go to that district and wait at a bus stop there, they can ride the bus. And the same thing would be said, the same thing here for the kids that are choosing to go to Huntsville as well. And how this plays into it, and the reason why I'm looking at for some equity look here, is how are we going to treat the kids in figure two that you see up there that are going to be attending the who decide not to opt in to the partnership school. Their school zone will be South End. Okay.
Will South End be able to accommodate?
They have room for between 90 to 95 students. Now, worst case scenario, nobody signs up for the partnership school. Well, they all want to go to South End. Well, that's not going to work. And at that point in time, UNCG couldn't have a school. So then we'd open Mall Street back up again for us and go right back at it. But we are going to have some students that are going to choose not to attend. And we are providing bus transportation for UNCG in there. And so we are going to still pick up those kids who are choosing to go to Mall Street. Now, they may get picked up by one of the partnership buses and do a bus transfer at Mall Street School and hop on a bus and then go over to South End that way. But we're still providing transportation. And I just felt like that if we were doing that for this area right here, then the same thing should be done for the students that are here that are choosing to go to Stonesport, Huntsville.
What about Monroe and Williamsburg?
Well,
are those options true?
There are options, but there's no room.
I didn't think so.
So, because, I mean, Williamsburg, I mean, they're busting at the seams right now. And Monroton received, 41 or 61 more kids than they thought at the beginning of the year.
I can't remember the exact number, but it was like 40, wasn't it?
Okay. And then if you look at Wentworth and you look at Lincoln, there's not a lot of openings there. The other thing that you also want to preserve, too, you also want to preserve the feeder patterns mm-hmm. for students going to Reasonable Middle and Reasonable High School. Mm-hmm. So instead of making this really complicated and dividing it up amongst about three or four schools, it would be much easier for everyone to understand that we're still going to designate that as the partnership school zone for us. But if somebody goes online, it's going to say that they can go to South End. But if they do an application here, we're going to say to them, you know that you're eligible to go to the partnership school. If they're coming into town.
New.
If they're new. Mm-hmm. So.
But they won't see this new, Monroe and Williamsburg as an option, because we don't want to give parents false impression that they have those two schools as a choice. You know?
Right.
So they won't see that as an option.
No.
Say if they don't want to go to South End or say I want to go to Monroe, they won't be given that option.
Well, they can fill out a transfer form and apply.
Yeah, but they don't have space.
Right, and that's what would end up happening.
That's right. So, I mean, you're just going to be making people mad.
But let's say that I move in and I move to Franklin Street, you know, that is in the Mall Street zone right now. If I go online, it's going to tell me South End. I'm new to town. Well, whenever when I go to South End and they're going to see where my home address is, they'll say, yeah, we would love for you to come here, but I just want you to know there's also another school, so you have a choice between the two. So, but I think by that time, as the school gets established, there's going to be, people are going to know when they move into a neighborhood that all the other kids are going to Mall Street Partnership School.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I want to back up to Dylan. I just want to make sure I've got a clear understanding. The zone that we have right now mm-hmm. is the same zone we had for 2017, 2018.
Yes, ma'am.
We haven't changed not a bit. So
not one.
We don't have to tell anybody in May, because we voted to keep those kids at Dillard's.
Right.
That they've got to relocate and go to someplace else. We don't have to tell them
nope.
that.
Mm-mm.
And those who are choosing to go, that's their choice.
That's their choice.
Trying to accommodate.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I
want
to make sure I'm clear on that.
Yeah. I was going to make the thing, well, I wouldn't say difficult, but it'd be easier. if, you know, that if I knew that they lived in the pink zone, I'd say, well, the closest school for you would be Stoneville. Or in the blue, the closest school would be Huntsville. But then I was like, nope, that opens up a whole other can of worms. So we're just going to say it is Dillard zone, and we'll have some pickup spots in both of the areas, one for Huntsville, one for Stoneville, and we'll go from there.
So any other questions?
So the deadline for transfer is still May 1st?
Yep. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So still some time for anybody who...
We've gotten a response back from just about all the kids that are currently attending Dillard.
Yes.
And that's how you got your 41 that
yes,
planned to... The,
okay. June?
Yes.
Price, Waterhouse.
It was a possible 182 responses. And we have received 174 out of 182.
Okay. So they've received 174 out of 182 for kids that are in kindergarten through fourth grade currently at Dillard School.
And you said the kindergartners have not registered?
Kindergartners haven't registered yet.
That's great.
Yes.
Ma'am?
The kindergartners haven't registered for Moss Street?
No, some of them have. It's just it just hasn't been as many as they would like to see.
Okay. Are there any other questions about this so that we can be clear? So will you be asking us to approve anything regarding...
Yes, ma'am. I'll be asking you to designate those two attendance zones on May 7th.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Shotwell. And I guess now we'll move to Mr. Turpin. Oh, I thought you were gone, Mr. Turpin. I'll just let you sit back there in that corner. I didn't see you. Board members, I asked you to bring your budget book just in case Mr. Turpin had something that he wanted us to look at.
I did want to do a clarification because I've had several people ask me this in the community. We do not pay a retainer fee for our legal services. We pay a per hour fee, and that's it.
For attorney.
Mm-hmm.
Good evening, Madam Chair, board members, and Dr. Shotwell. I just wanted to open up the floor again to see if there are any other questions regarding the 2018-19 proposed budget, and I'll see if I can answer them. If I can't, I'll be glad to get you the answers.
Board members, if you would refer to your yellow book, and if you have any questions, now is the time, because when we come back, that's when we will approve.
Yes, ma'am. I will have to approve it at the May 7th meeting.
Mr. Hudson.
Mr. Hudson. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I had a question under the couple of questions, capital outlay fund.
Okay.
Page 2. Classrooms of tomorrow. You go about a third of the way down on the page. Equipment / furnishings, $40,000. Which
correct
school is that for?
I'd like to refer that to Dr. Parks to see which school she's.
Continuation at Wentworth.
Wentworth Elementary.
Okay. Page 4. Board of Education furniture equipment, $5,000. Do we need new furniture and equipment?
Page 4 in the capital outlays, sir?
Yes. Is that the bottom? Second from the bottom?
That's the prior year budget. The current year budget, that's nothing.
Thank you. Thank
you.
Thank you. Capital Outlay Fund Planning Budget, item 4.9008,
8.801.532. Which page are you on, Mr. Bus?
It's not saying.
Okay, you must be in the detailed ones.
Yes, that's, we got the page.
Okay.
It's two pages. One page past page 5.
Okay. The account code numbers, sir?
It's second from the bottom. 4.9008.801.532.
Okay.
Which school is that for, the parking?
Paving, gravel, and ceiling. I'll have to refer that to Dr. Parks also. It's in the detailed listing that you and the maintenance department provided on the second page of that, second item up from the bottom. Paving, gravel, and ceiling. Current year proposed budget is at $50,000. Parking lot repair, repair, stripping existing sites. Is that a specific school or is that
just overall? Remember, that's we actually had somebody go out and look at potholes at all
playgrounds,
at every one of our school sites and mark them on a Google map, okay, and then bring it back and then prioritize the most the worst to the least.
I was just assuming most of that will probably be a Dillard.
It's a mess over there, but you know, it's, yeah, you know, now that the backside of Moorhead was fixed, it moves into the number one slot, I would probably say, out of all of our places.
I'm going to have one last question under special fund.
Okay.
Again, there's not a page number. It would be the, not the first page, but the back of the first page.
There is a page number, but it's overwritten with some typing, so sorry about that.
Okay.
It's number 2, yes, ma'am.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Okay, 2. Second from the top, 6.7100701180 bonus pay. Who's that for?
Page correct. That would be for the state bonuses that are given that these workers may qualify for. This is not a budget that I normally deal with that much. It's the school-based child care. I can find out specifically the class of people that they are referring to in that bonus, if you like.
Okay, that's all. Thank you.
It's basically if the state gives us everybody except teachers and principals a $500 one-time bonus, that's what that will cover. That's what that is.
Although it's under school-age child care?
Yes, ma'am, because they're our employees.
They're our employees, but it's the enterprise fund.
Yeah.
And they have to pay for their own expenses. So normally the board, when a bonus like that is given to the employees of a certain class, they usually extend that to the classes throughout the organization.
Okay. All right, board members, do you have any questions? Any more questions?
Mr.
Price.
Mr.
Yes.
Price?
The request I submitted about the budget items, you got a healthy increase in the capital outlay budget of $3 million. And the some of these, you see there's an additional sheet. I know that was a question last year because what I was looking for was a list of projects that were prioritized, because if you don't get this money, what's going to be number one? What's going to be number two? What location? We've got a lot of money packaged together here in the supplements. Now, where is that?
I believe it's the under the local.
I was looking at the capital outlay, which was $3 million.
Okay.
Supplemental sheet here in the back.
Oh,
on the next page.
The supplemental sheet's a detailed breakout of the projects that are identified that roll up into the prior budget.
Would it not be more convenient to have those numbers in the capital outlay budget?
They are.
They are in there.
They are. It just breaks it down there.
Just had it here.
It's a different font and layout than the regular budget one there.
Correct.
But all those numbers correspond to the regular capital outlay, general outlay on here. It just breaks it down more.
And they're all broken down into the Category 1, Category 2, and Category 3 projects.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. Yeah. It is.
Sorry, next year I'll try to make sure we get the numbers on the there.
These, like the HVAC replace and repair, we've got $430,000.
Mm-hmm.
For what schools are those?
And that is on the first page about
Greensville High School, Rockingham County High School, and at Central, the K2 air condensing unit.
There's some notes there on the next to the 2018-19 proposed budget. There's 2018-19 notes in the center column.
Is that on page 2?
It's on the first page of the detail of the items.
Okay.
About two-thirds of the way down.
Yeah. I see it.
Yeah, they're abbreviated. They're not central is spelled out, but High School and Rockingham County High School are abbreviated.
And I would just like to say, as we look at our HVAC needs, we have prioritized that with Johnson Controls. And so we have worked with them to look at all of our needs, and we've prioritized that over the 10 years in our 10-year plan.
Mm-hmm.
So these were the next in line if we should get the amount of money that we've asked for.
Okay, but what is the conditions of those units that we're looking to replace? You say if we get that money, there's a priority of those projects?
We have prioritized all of our HVAC over the next 10 years.
Yeah,
okay.
But
and so would be the next ones that we would look at.
But the difference is, depends on the total capital outlay money that we receive.
Right. If it's 800 some thousand,
then
this is
that's not going to happen.
Right. It'll probably not happen at all.
So we'll just keep repairing it until such time there's money to replace it. Or it breaks.
Right.
And we can't fix it anymore.
We're like at Rock High with the Mammoth unit. We were up on the building, up on the roof daily, just trying to get it to start. Mm-hmm. That was right when I first arrived. 4 years ago.
You know, this goes back to a request in 2015, I believe it 2014 or 2015, from the county manager asking us for our 10-year capital needs.
Mm-hmm.
Not additions, not new buildings or anything, just simply repair what we have. And so we keep going back to that. So last year we asked for 2.9, we didn't get it, so projects get bumped, and then we reprioritize them. But the needs are still there. That was another reason why the performance contracting is an attractive alternative piece. And Mr. Huss is going to be representing you all and Ms. Bell on there, representing us as the two companies come in to present, because that is a way to be able to replace some of the HVA systems within our current expense budget by guaranteeing savings because of the efficiency of the equipment in there. They've spent a lot of time doing that. So we're trying to look at different ways to be able to address these needs.
Are there any more questions, board members?
I mean, just like for activity buses, a new one is about $88,000. We were able to purchase two of our yellow school buses that were less than 9 years old and be able to take those and purchase them and then spend, what was it, about $4,500, $5,000 to have them painted, wiped, and converted them to an activity bus, which we were able, because we're in dire need of activity buses, and so that was a way for us to be able to add back to the fleet for a very minimal amount of money when you compare it to a brand new one costing, you know, in the high 80s.
We do appreciate that, Dr. Shotwell. Any other questions?
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Turpin?
On page 3 of the capital outlay, we have $410,000 for...
Behind which tab, please?
Capital outlay, page 3 of the regular budget.
Yes, for tracks. Is that what you're referring to?
Well, we've got a number of things, $410,000, but it's for stadiums, gyms, tracks, and tennis courts.
Yes, sir. We have tennis courts at Moorhead High School that needs to be resurfaced. We have tracks at 3 of our high schools that need to be probably completely redone. Some of our gymnasiums, we've been in the process over the years of trying to replace some of the outdated bleachers. So that we don't have accidents occurring there. And then school stadiums, some of those, if you notice when you, I think you went over to Rock High in the last 2 years and saw the visitor side. You know, that was one of the last projects that Mr. Holcomb kind of initiated. But it was part of that process because before then, we were sending maintenance over there and over to Reedsville High School constantly replacing 2x12s. And everything every summer to get ready for the upcoming football season. So we just try to do some upgrades and things. I think if you go back to the
when some of these require this upgrade.
Well,
offices
no, because both boys and girls both use it, so they're both being punished. So it's not. And again, that's the other thing. We spent $1.4 million over 3 years to upgrade our softball fields. And that was the time that we had all three of those tracks that were supposed to be replaced, and they got put on the back burner. We were fortunate in the fact that the federal government did not require us to replace them all at once. Because their thing was, go ask the commissioners, and we said, that's not gonna work. So they did give us a 3-year payment to install those over that period of time. I'm sorry, go ahead.
By example, on this, we have all these stadiums, the gyms, the tracks, the tennis courts under this of $410,000. Is this broken down?
Yes, sir. It's back on that other page. We have $60,000 for Moorhead High School tennis courts. We have $200,000 set aside to resurface the track at Rock High. It's on this piece here that breaks it down with the details behind the capital outlay budget.
You go to the second page from the very end of that.
Siri, I'm talking about. And then we also have $200,000 for Michael, and then $10,000 for bleacher repair. It's the top of the third page on the back side when you flip it up.
That's the numbers on the left.
Okay. Now we're talking about $400,000. What is the breakdown?
You have $200,000 for the Rockingham County High School resurfaced track. Michael track is $200,000. Bleacher repair is $10,000.
And $60,000 is at the end of the previous page for the Moorhead High School tennis courts.
Okay, so those numbers, the final three digits is 532, and then the $60,000 before is 529.
Correct. And it should tie back to that previous budget, to the previous budget, that's obviously some of the numbers. So there's a better breakout of the projects along with the explanations.
Anyone else? Okay.
I also have the updates of the sheets that we told you we were going to get to you to incorporate the additional $1 million that we're going to ask from the county commissioners, as well as the property and casualty insurance for our properties that we put back in here. And I ran those through the whole budget, so there's a few extra sheets. If you brought your books with you tonight, I can collect them and have these sheets put into the books, or I can give you a copy of these that you'll have, and you can just keep have the updated versions.
Okay, board members, make sure you have your names on your board books.
Yeah, well, and I can get that.
He's going to add those.
He's going to give them back to us.
Yes, ma'am. I think I'll recognize yours as well.
What we can do is when we take your pages out, we can clip them and put the new pages in there and then give you the old pages back too, in case
yes.
you got notes on it. How
yes,
about that?
Of course, yes.
Or you can do what's door number two. We can give you the updates and you can slide them in yourself, but we don't mind doing it for you.
Either way, yeah.
And if we do it, we'll make sure it's got the nice little holes in there and you don't have to worry about losing the piece of paper when you go out to your car or anything else.
Exactly. Blown away from the wind.
Yeah. And then
well, we'll get them back out to you.
And then
we'll
you,
have
when
a for you tomorrow.
Mr. Turpin, when you finish.
Yes, ma'am.
And if some board members want to come by to pick their yellow book up, if they need it in their hands before board meeting,
yes,
just
ma'am.
Give them a call and come pick it up.
On Wednesday,
we'll put this right number one.
Or I can bring it to your house as long as I tell you ahead of time.
I'm getting it before Wednesday. I'm going out of town. I spend the last week in the month with my mom.
Yeah.
Okay. Give them to me tonight. I'll have them for you tomorrow afternoon. I think we can handle
happy.
That.
Happy reading.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Okay. Madam Chairman.
Do you want to pass those down to Mr. Turpin?
Did Ms. Price have some more questions?
Let me ask some more questions.
One of the questions I submitted was, the fund balance appropriated?
Yes, sir.
Under local current expense fund?
Yes, sir.
Got almost $5 million there?
Yes, sir.
And the question is, where did that money come from?
That is from the fund balance that we were able to accumulate over the past couple of years through the budget cuts that we did and through decrease of spending. But as I mentioned before, moving the $2.4 million from state into local is going to increase the need to use that fund balance that we've been able to accumulate. So,
and not all that is unrestricted?
Well, this is in local current expense fund is what Dr. Price is talking about. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as we become a smaller district and need to consolidate and do the things that we need to do to account for the 800 students that we're losing, we will need to make additional cuts and things to the budget.
Well, part of the concern is, you know, we just went through a $1 million expenditure on data breach.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that money came from somewhere.
Correct, it comes from our fund balance. That's what we have brought to you to be able to tap into that, to be able to use that money to help pay for the data breach.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, the fund balance is kind of like our savings account that we've been able to have. In the corrected sheets that I have for you, the top number on that first page for the local current expense fund for the county appropriation will go up by $1 million, up to $16 million instead of $15 million. And then the fund balance appropriated will go down by that appropriate amount, almost appropriate amount, because there was one correction in the budget for the property and casualty insurance premium that we needed to put in there. So a little bit less than $1 million, that fund balance will be coming down, appropriated fund balance. If we don't get that $1 million from the county commissioners, then those numbers will go back to the close to $5 million of appropriated fund balance and the $15 million from county appropriations.
Well, as you know, the county's got a request from the university or the college, RCC, to do some facilities upgrades, which is they're looking to do this through the quarter cent sales tax, and that's, you know, that's up in the air as whether that's going to pass or not. Of course, you know, we've tried that several times in the past, but for those expenditures, my question is, we have reduced our number of employees in the school system, down 477 from 12 years ago. We're down a number of buildings, and we've got resources that we need to address to reduce those costs. You know, we've got a number of schools that are planned to be repurposed, as the term goes. But you know, depending upon those schools, is an example, what's going to happen, and that's what I asked Dr. Shotwell for a plan for those schools, because you know these counties are in a crunch, and they're going to have to raise taxes or do something to get that money. And we're looking at the expenditures here. With those schools, example is one of the cities has a need for a rec department facilities. They've looked at new vision as a possibility for that. So to capitalize or take advantage of the schools that are going to be no longer being used for education purposes, to get those off of our books. I mean, we still have the Williamsburg School, the old Williamsburg School. We have Lawson Mill Avenue. We're going to have Draper, all repurposed for that. Are they going to produce the revenue to get that off of our expenditure stream?
Well, one of the things you have to look at too is that Head Start program has asked for space. As now that we've closed schools, there's a push at the state level, and I know Mr. Richardson and Ms. Hoover both have participated with the pre-K. There's a huge push to put an influx of more money for NC pre-K, and that is going to also demand some space. Because like right now, I mean, I'll be perfectly honest with you. If you look at Williamsburg, we're busting the seams down there. But we do have NC Pre-K and we have Head Start.
Not Williamsburg.
I'm talking about the old Williamsburg.
I know, but that's what I'm saying. But that student population is not decreasing down there. Mm-hmm. In some cases, it's increasing. And when that happens, those programs have to go someplace else. Because we have hosted NC Pre-K and Head Start in some of our schools that are currently going to be closed or you know, moved around, and that's going to cause a problem. That's what we're trying to figure out. We're trying to figure out what the needs of Head Start is, you know, because we're working with the county mm-hmm. on that, and also looking at the projected NC Pre-K with the local partnership for children.
I would like to say, in lieu of what just happened with the tornado in Guilford County, I personally mm-hmm. am glad that we are repurposing some of these schools, because heaven forbid if anything happened to any of our schools, mm-hmm. we would need a building for our students to go into. So you need to keep that in mind.
That's true.
Well, but if we don't have the money in the county or for the budget, can't afford to have facilities sitting around. I mean, we've got Lawsonville Avenue, it's half utilized. We've got Draper, which is two large buildings out there, and we're currently looking at using one of them. What is going to happen with New Vision, with the needs of, I think it's Mayadan, who has a direct requirement. They've got a couple of $1 million expenditure for the rec department, and that would be a good match to get that off of our budget expenditures.
They're looking at one of the possibilities is looking at ball fields in that area behind Division School. That long area that mm-hmm. stretches down to the tennis courts and everything. But we still use that gymnasium for McMichael for their junior varsity practice and such over there. You know, when you look at Lawsonville, the old part of Lawsonville, the heat comes on when it gets below when it gets to about 55 degrees, and that's it. And there's minimal lights at all going on over there. I mean, it's basically just a shell.
The old Williamsburg school is not usable either.
No, old Williamsburg school.
Both pipes are gone.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. We've got facilities on our hands. Charter school. I mean, when the charter school was in there, they were providing a resource for us. They upgraded the equipment. They did the maintenance. And now that they're no longer in there, that falls back to us, right?
Mm-hmm.
So.
But ultimately, you know, the decision for the buildings is y'all's.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that would probably be another conversation for us as a board. Once we get these schools, the children reassigned and mm-hmm. and see where we are then that's a possibility that we could have that discussion and talk about some of these buildings and to see if the county wants them back.
But and at the same time, I also want to say this too, that over the last 12 years, you know, our fund balance has gone down, it's gone up, it's gone down, and with very rare exception, I think except for the pool, we've not gone to the commissioners and asked them to help us in times of an emergency because we've been able to take care of it on our own, just like a good family budget would. You know, families, you know, in an ideal world wouldn't live paycheck to paycheck. They'd be setting some money aside in case your refrigerator goes out, your oven goes out, a leak in the roof, and that's kind of what we've been able to do. And, you know, because I knew when the gentleman from the federal government told me that I could go to the commissioners and ask them for the $1.4 million for the softball fields, I said, you are not living in this world. Because I also realized the economic situation that we're in here. Mm-hmm. And we were able to, and of course, just like I taught in my economics classes, there's an opportunity cost, and our opportunity costs were our tracks.
And I'm sure that you've heard me say this before, that we need to be cautious when it comes to fund balance. That fund balance is very important to this district, because if we were to encounter some of the damages and some major catastrophe were to happen to our schools, that's why you have fund balances for emergencies. And because we've not been properly funded, we've had to pull. Years ago, 14 years ago, when I came on board, we had a healthy fund balance, very healthy fund balance. But over the years, we've had to take from that fund balance because we've not been fully funded by our county commissioners. But it's a dangerous thing, and we, as a board, we need to be cautious.
Well, we need to look at that. When I first ran for the school board, I met with Dr. Shotwell, and that was one of his priorities at the time, was to build up a fund balance. Mm-hmm. It needed to be a certain percentage.
Exactly.
But at the same time, we've lost one school. I know we have considerations of other things. But we've lost a large amount of revenue from our students that have migrated. And we've got these resources that we need to look at along with the fund balance and what we're doing. Because as a county taxpayer, I'm not interested in seeing the taxes rise if it's not necessary.
Okay. Are there any other comments regarding the budget from Mr. Turpin? Okay, hearing none. Thank you, Mr. Turpin.
Thank you.
Is there a motion to go into closed session to discuss a restart model by Mr. Perkins?
So moved.
It's a motion by Ms. Hoover. Is there a second? Is there a second to go into closed
second.
Session? Second by Ms. McKinney.
I second that one.
Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposes, no. The ayes have it, and we will now move into closed session. Do you want me to break?
Yes, please.
We'll take a 5-minute break. Thank you.